Welcome back, everyone. Don't forget, please, submit your assignment. You still have some time to complete. Remember, submit your product, the source code, the class diagram. Very, very important, the class diagram. Review that the class diagram corresponds to the software that you're submitting. Something that we're going to do is review the class diagram in particular, because I need to use your class diagrams to show you elements that we're going to review today, theoretically. Next week, the idea is to apply those principles with your class diagram, therefore, to analyze something that you built. So class diagram, source code, very, very important. Take a look to that. And obviously, as before, user stories, hopefully by now, making user stories, you are proficient with that. We're asking again for that, for the backlog, everything in the backlog. Your burden chart, something that we need to review is your velocity. We need to talk about it. So we are going to put together all your burden charts in the future weeks. So burden chart again, and retrospective and review. Use the things that you have been submitting before. Well, question in the chat about array lists and hash maps. What is the question exactly? Usually, if you have those data structures, collections, what you do is to put them as an attribute, not as a relationship. Two different ideas. One thing is, if I have a class A and I have a class B, and therefore I want to show a relationship like this, with number, what you're showing there is a collection of elements. That collection of elements is one of two things. Number one is an array. Therefore, the data type for the relationship is the class B. So you have something like an array of elements B. That is one relationship. Second is if you have a collection and the collection is explicitly from class B. So something like a list of elements B, but you do not show in the relationship the class list or linked list. What you show is the relationship between A and B, and the list is just the relationship. Now, if for any reason what you want to show is something like a linked list or a hash map or whatever, and your instances are objects, like general data structures, whatever. Usually the easy way to do that is in the class A to mention your attribute, whatever it is, and show for that attribute here a set, a hash map, a linked list, whatever, but just list the attribute, not the relationship. So it do not make sense, as you mentioned, to have something like, I have my class A and my class A is connected with something like a linked list that is connected with something like an object that finally is the father after several inheritance of the class B that I want to use. Something like this do not make sense. It's something that you do not want to put in a class diagram. So if that is the case, an attribute that is all this, it is better to show that use like here as an attribute, statement of the name and the type, not all of this. It is okay. Just remember, a class diagram is an abstraction. What you want to do with an abstraction is, remember, some things are going to be hiding and some things are going to be shown. It is your decision, what are you going to show? The criteria that I mentioned before, very, very important, you do not show attributes or methods in classes that are from a library, but you show your methods and your attributes in your classes. And probably this is another rule that is important to mention. When you have these crazy data structures that for some reason are templates or whatever, sometimes it's better to show the attribute, one line, instead of all the relationships involved. What you want to show are relationships that are important for the developer to notice. And obviously you want to show something that is easy to understand. So something like this, very simple, A and B, a collection, a multiple connection, it's an array, it's a linked list, whatever, but the objects are from B. That is what you want to show. That is what you have in the code. Good. If what you have in the code is something more complex like this, obviously you're not going to lie and you're not going to put something like this. If that is not the case, is something complex, put the attribute, one line, the data type, and usually that could be a set, hash map, or something crazy like that with the collections in Java, for instance. Good? For the, I have another question, assignment, the next assignment, drag and drop of the icons, yes. Remember, all the requirements that you previously have with the Spring 1 and Spring 2 still work. What we did is to change something and add some things, but everything that was a requirement before should still be there. So including drag and drop of the icons, including the dialog box that appear when you double click or some way you decide what to do. So all of the previous things still work. It's not like we are doing a new thing. It's the previous one with all the functionality with some updates, some changes. I am not sure about the other question in the chat. It's a direct message, a composition from A to B. That is a question regarding the source code that is the input in your project, or is something different? It's like, if you have a composition A to B, obviously composition implies that there is a not null instance, yes. You show the composition in the diagram, yes. You do not show the attribute. Trying to understand the question. Remember, if you are showing something, source code, if the source code is class A, and inside of the class A, you have this variable B, more things. But if I have this source code, option A, the best option, because I am assuming that this is important, the best option is to say, you know what, I have a class A, and I have a class B. And according with this source code, what I have is a variable B inside of the class A. So that means the class A is connected as an aggregation with class B. Why aggregation? Because so far in the source code, there is nothing that tells me that that variable is not null. In fact, it's null from the beginning, right? There is no constructor, so the assumption could be is null. That is the solution. Now, the other option, option B. And as you notice, there is nothing here in the attributes, nothing here in the attributes. The other option, the one that I am mentioning for complex data structures that you can use when you use templates, things like that, and you do not want to make your diagram complex, is, well, you know what? I have this class A, and in my attributes, I have this attribute B from the type B. And well, something like this, private, it could be a good idea to make it private. So it's A or B, but not both. You do not show both things. Now, in this one, if you want to show the name of the variable, usually you do not do that because you allow the developer to create the name. But if you want to put in the blueprint a name because you want that name to be used, usually what you do is to put the name close to the line. So for instance, in this line, I can put B there, and I am asking the developers, hey, for this connection, for this diamond, for this global variable, the name that you need to use is B. And obviously the type is uppercase B. So one option, another option is an abstraction here, because both A and B are my classes and they are very obvious, A, B. The best way to represent the abstraction, the best thing to do, my recommendation is A, the classes, the relationship. It's going to be visual for the developer to know I need to do two classes and they are connected. This option is also correct as an attribute. Usually that one is when you do not want to show the class B. And you do not want to show the class B, one option, when that class B is a class from a library. So you do not want to show the class from the library. Moreover, that class is going to be connected, as I mentioned before, with this idea of templates, the class object. You can do that. But is A or B never both together? If you put the attribute and you put also the relationship, that is wrong. You do not need to put this name here. No. Again, what happened when you put the name? You are telling the developer, developer, use this name. And to be honest, if you are the developer, at least you want to have the freedom to put whatever name you want to the variable. Moreover, you have the knowledge about giving names to variables, right? You can do that without someone else, the guy that did the blueprint, tell you what name to use. So abstractions, you choose the level of detail. So in this case, you can put the B and you're asking for that name, or if you remove the B, the only thing that you're asking is for this variable, but you're giving the developer the freedom to use here whatever name the developer wants to use. Hopefully this makes sense. Very good question in the chat. You are cleaning the code in the Spring Tree. Maybe you have, you noticed things that you can clean in your code for the Spring Tree. You are doing your class diagram also, improving the class diagram for your project. So the question that I have is, did you put in your backlog as a product backlog item that you are cleaning the code and or that you are doing this class diagram? Yes or no? What do you think? I agree with the chat. Remember, usually cleaning your code or modifying your class diagrams or things like that, those are activities that you as a developer do in the same way that you turn on your computer. I mean, every day you turn on your computer, or every day you open your developer environment, or every day you check your email, or every day you report your activities to the software that you're using to control the project, whatever. All those things do not go to your product backlog. So my comment here, the diagram, the class diagram, is not something that you're going to mention in the product backlog. Yeah, it's something that you are doing, probably is the blueprint, your guideline for the project and so on, but it's not kind of a one activity that is going to happen in one particular point in the time. It's just something that is part of the project. Again, like turn on your computer. Cleaning the code only if you're fixing a bug. Remember, fixing bugs is part of your product backlog. If what you are doing is fixing something that didn't work before, that is the activity for your backlog, fixing a bug, because fixing the bug is something that has value for the customer. But if the only thing that you are doing is, I don't know, changing names of the variables or deleting source code that is not useful now, or refactoring, again, those things, refactoring is part of your work every day, not specifically part of a project. It's not part of the value in the project. It's just your work. So not for the diagram, for the code, only if you're fixing things, only if you're doing something that is going to have value for the customer. Clean code do not have directly value for the customer. Having clean code is indirectly useful for the customer because we're creating software that could be, you know, extensible, modificable, and so on, but it's not something that the customer is going to ask you to do. So not stories for that. Well, yeah, as I mentioned before, value for the customer, the stories, what I am mentioning here is like if you're going to fix something, technical things that could be there. If you're going to install something like a database that is for the project, that can be there. But my point is things like cleaning the code is not is not something that is related with one particular project. It's not related with your assignment. It's kind of your everyday activity. My analogy is this idea that you do not put in every single project, I need 5 minutes to my computer to turn on, or I need time to run my developer environment. I need time to report my advance today. Those things, you do that, but it's not like task in your things to do, in your backlog, in your responsibilities for the project. They are things that you do, period, in every single project. And you are not going to add those things to your report of activities. You just do it. For the diagram. You can, but it's not a good idea. Why? Because when you do this, it is not clear if that one is going to be aggregation or composition. Again, abstraction, a model. A class diagram is a model. Every single model have a particular level of abstraction. And if you remember, abstraction is a decision of the engineer. What I am going to show and what I am going to encapsulate. That balance, what to show and what to encapsulate, is your decision as an engineer. And obviously, when you are doing something like this, you are encapsulating, you are hiding a lot of information, including the fact that I do not know if that one is null or not, if that one is going to be aggregated or composition. When I move to the option A, I am showing that information. And I want to show that information when A and B are my classes. Probably in some moments, for some cases, it's like, okay, this is pretty obvious. It's going to be a linked list or a hash or a set or whatever. And according with the domain of the problem, it's like, it's pretty obvious that at the beginning, this data structure is going to be empty and the for is going to be null. So the developer is going to understand that. In those cases, you can follow with B. But if you have a class diagram that only have inheritance and realization, it is not wrong. No one is going to tell you that it's wrong. But basically, you are encapsulating every single detail. Your diagram is not going to be exactly the most useful diagram. So do not do that. The diagram is correct. Your decision-making, your level of abstraction is not exactly what we should provide to the developers. Yeah, refactoring consume time. Remember, you are thinking about two different scenarios. Right now, you are students. And as students, well, the refactoring consume a lot of time. And well, it's normal, you are learning. Probably you make a prototype, a mistake. You're going to redo things or fix things. Think about in the professional level. Remember that Agile assume higher levels of technical skills than others. The theoretical idea is that, well, yeah, refactoring and fixing things is going to require time, but not a lot. Obviously, we have two different scenarios, you as a student, you as a professional. What you can do right now, what you are doing, and I am just going to make a guess. Some of you, some of your teams, you are not refactoring. Probably you are redoing things. Think about it. Refactoring is, I understand what is happening. I am just going to clean the code. That is different from, I am going to delete this and do this in a different way because the previous one didn't work anymore. First scenario, you're refactoring, you're deleting lines, cleaning. That should not require a lot of time. And therefore, that is not part of your backlog items. The second scenario, when you need to delete something and redo things, that is a full new story, maybe, or a full new entry for fixing bugs, fixing things, technical things. So my comment for you guys is cleaning the code, really? Not a lot of time, not in the backlog. Redo things, changing something, is like fixing an error. It's like this class is going to disappear and we're going to redo this class, redo this thing. Probably what you are doing is you need again the user story that you assume was complete. That story is back because basically you are working in that story again. From the story, everything, you are going to redo the thing because you are going to replace what you have before. That could be the case. And that scenario need a lot of time, obviously. Basically, redo the story. Go back to the beginning. Think about that. Well, the value for the story, give me an example of the story. Which story? I mentioned this in some emails. Be careful with this easier, cleaner, and so on. That is very tricky because remember, the question is going to be always, what are you going to do to test that is clean or easy? It's a little bit tricky. Now, particular examples, as a user, I want all elements. So, well, in fact, that is a very good question. What do you want? What do you want is the elements. What do you want is the icons. What do you want is what you call it, the operators. One team use that. That is what you want. Think about it. You want those elements. The old shape is used like an extra thing to the thing that I want. The question is, why? The question that you need to ask, to answer, is why you want the elements, the icons, the operators. You do not need to ask why in oval shape. The customer is asking for them to be in oval shape, but why do we want the icons, the ovals, the operators, the circles? And the reason because I want them is because because I want to connect them with others, and these connections represent a source code or a network. I mean, here, the why is the explanation of what the software is doing. The software is, if you want, is visual programming. The software is each of these icons represent an element in a program. The why is because I want to do visual programming, connecting these icons. Each of these icons represent an item. So that is the why. And that is the why that you need to answer in the stories. And they need to be ovals. Oh, that thing, the oval, is something that is going to be important in your testing criteria. The testing criteria for that is going to be something like, I am going to have these ovals on the screen. That is different from what you had before. Before you have rectangles on the screen. having the oval on the screen or having the rectangle on the screen is what you need to have in order to show that you complete this. But again, think about what do you want? The icons. Why? Because I want to do this programming. Think as a user, not as a developer. That is something that I have been sharing with you by email, but with some of you, is I am the user, what I want, not the developer. Yeah. I mean, you need to be careful about what is the meaning of logic boards. Again, different ways to explain the things, but yeah. If by logic board you mean this idea of connecting the icons to create the program, blah, 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 blah. Try to explain things to everyone, to the stakeholders. Try to use a language that is easy to follow. So that is the reason. That is your why. That is your thought that. Not explaining why they are ovals. They are ovals because the customer wants the ovals, but the justification is for the icons. Think about this, and this is an advice for everyone. What you are doing is, number one, some of your stories are back. Use the story that you have before, but now it's back because something changed for the testing criteria. Some of your things, some of your stories, something that I noticed for emails that you send me is that some of you are thinking about the stories to involve somehow an update. Somehow, some people is thinking about, well, I need to have a story and that story should be, I want to update. My advice is, really? That is what you want? To update? Or we should think about, well, what the customer wants is something new. I mean, the customer do not care if the developer is going to update. Update meaning change something that already exists. Some of the stories that I share with you is I want new things. One example is these icons. Those icons, the two different bars, they are new. For me as a customer, they are new. Before we have this one with the two bars, now I am asking for this. But these two are kind of an update of the other. For you as a developer, for me as a customer, now I am asking for these things. And if you think about the stories, is me as a customer, I want this guy. Me as a customer, I want this guy. And what is going to happen with the oldest one? They're going to delete it. The customer didn't want it anymore. Thinking about your work, your hours, your time, what you're going to do is you need to report this. You are doing new things. Sometimes an update is really delete and add. These new things. I do not need to mention that those two guys are an update of the older guy. Think about it. Again, from the perspective of the customer. As a customer, I am asking for update or split the other one or something like that. Or what I am asking is, as a customer, I want this icon and I want, in a different story, another thing, I want this icon, so I want those two things, new things. And there are two, because be careful and remember, if you have an and, two things, you can split two different stories, two different requirements, and therefore two different tasks to do it. Could be the case. I'm not sure. I am ask, you're asking about a menu and a pop-up menu, not sure where. Something that I asked you as a mandatory is in the frame. If you have the application like that, I am asking you to have here a menu bar. I am asking you to have there the options for, you know, load, save, run, compile, new tab, and so on. So I am asking you this to be a menu. And if you are working with Java, that basically means I am asking you to work with JMenu, JMenu bar, JMenu item. I am asking you to do that, yes. So I am not sure if that is clear in the picture that I shared with you. If not, sorry about it, but yeah, I am asking you to have a frame in Java done with Swing. Therefore, I am asking you to have a class in editing from JFrame, and I am asking you to have a menu bar, and that menu bar is going to have in one or more menus, the accommodation is whatever you want, but in a menu bar, the options, and there are four options. So yeah, menu bar, mandatory. Why? Because I want you to have those classes in your class diagram, and I want to review with you, how do you represent those classes in your class diagram, and the implication that that is going to have when we calculate the metrics. So that is the reason because I am asking you to have the JFrame, have the menu bar, have the panels, and several decisions that I am asking you to do are because I want a particular class diagram that later we can review. So yeah, menu bar, please. Okay, so hopefully moving forward. Okay, any other question about the project? Okay, so moving forward. Previous lecture, we start talking about metrics. This is something that I am going to ask you to calculate for not only your project, obviously, that is something that we need to review, the quality of your project according with numbers, but also is something that you're going to be doing in a quiz and obviously in your final exam. I am going to give you for the exam for a particular question, a diagram, and the question is going to be calculate the numbers. So very, very important that you understand the numbers and that you are able to calculate the numbers for every diagram that I can give you. So numbers. Previous lecture, we review loops. We review the tangled metric. Pretty simple, use checking if I have loops or not. Remember, this work with classes, this work with packages. We're going to be talking about these three metrics with classes and with packages. So for the number one, done, we review it. The next two, we start reviewing this one. We stop in the middle. So I am going to start with that one again and a summary. And we need to review the other one. Stability versus dependency and stability versus abstraction. Those are the two things that we compare with numbers. So stability versus the dependency, SDP. Stability versus abstraction, SIP. And we are here with the number three. So checking that, stability and abstraction. We start by defining the concept. The first thing that we did in the previous lecture is defining what is the meaning of stability and what is the meaning of abstraction. So knowing the definition of each of them, then we can put them together. For abstraction, very, very simple. We talk about with classes, if the class is an abstract class or is an interface, the value for this is one. So the abstraction metric for one interface or for one abstract class is one, is abstract. For a normal class, the value is zero. Abstraction equals zero means that guy is a normal class. Also, we review what happened with this when you have a package. When you have a package, that package inside have several classes, maybe interfaces, maybe abstract classes. So what you do basically is to calculate the metric. Like if you have an abstract class or an interface here, and that one have two childs, and the childs are concrete classes, basically you have three elements, and if those three elements are inside of a particular package P, when you talk about the abstraction of the package P, well, the thing that you need to do is to calculate the relationship between how many classes do you have and how many of them are abstract. It's going to be one if all the classes are abstract. It's going to be zero if all the classes are concrete. In this scenario, I have one that is abstract, one interface, and I have two that are concrete. So in the previous lecture, you helped me to figure out the solution for this. And it's like, well, what you can do is, this is something like this, because you have one abstract and you have a total of one abstract plus two not abstract, the total. So that is going to help you to calculate one divided by three. And therefore you have an abstraction metric for this package of 0.3, which means 1/3 of the elements there are abstract. Easy, no problem. Now, also we start talking about stability. And talking about stability, we move to this equation, stability. Stability is related with how many connections go in or how many connections go out from a particular package or a particular class. In both the scenarios, you have lines going in, lines going out. Remember, we're talking about lines in or out, and those lines, we do not care if they are aggregation, composition, association, realization. Do you remember? We just consider them lines, and the only thing that we do is to think about they are going out or in. And in function of that, we apply this equation. For that equation, now we can go back. When you have a class or a package, and that one has only things going in, whatever it is, you can figure out that according with the equation is zero going out, and the total in this example is four. Your value for the instability is going to be zero. So instability zero means that basically what you have is something that only have connections going in. That is what the equation represents. On the opposite, if you think about some package or class in which the only thing that you have is things going out, applying the equation, you're going to have this, well, I have four things going out divided by the ones going out plus the one going in, the in is zero, and this is going to be one. So one represents a class or a package that have only things going out. Those are my opposites. Obviously, the number is going to be something in the middle, something between zero and one, and it's going to represent a relationship between how many lines I have going out and how many lines do I have going in. And it's going to help me to figure out the structure of that class in relation with the other classes, or that package in relation with the other packages. Worst case scenario, when I have this example, this one, what is better, having a class like A with only lines going out, or having a class like B, sorry, A with only lines going in, or having B with only lines going out? What do we prefer? I have an option about A. A is, what is the meaning of A? Think about a programmer here doing this one, and think about a programmer here doing the second one. You know what? The problem is the following, and this is going to help you with your answer. If I am doing this one, for instance, it is the case. If I am doing this one, this is the case in which, for instance, I am doing this class main, right? And one connection out is this inheritance from JFrame. And maybe another connection out is that I am using a panel. And maybe another connection out is that maybe I am using a JLabel. Did you notice this? I am doing this one, the main, and I am inheriting, using panels, bottoms, things like that. Would you like to be the programmer in charge of doing this main? Yes or no? Is the main, you're going to be in editing, you're going to be using panel, you're going to be using label. Do you need to inform someone if you change something? I mean, according with this, you are doing the main. You need to be in contact with someone else? Yeah, you are trusting in the frame and you are trusting in the panel, you are trusting in the label. But if you make a mistake here, something happened to the others? Someone is going to have a problem with you? I mean, obviously, if one of these fail, what you're going to do is to tell, it is not my problem. I am inheriting from the frame. The frame is not working. The Java API is not working. I did my work correctly. When you have a dependency in others, and remember, we're talking about separation of concerns. We're talking about my responsibility, their responsibility. Something like this, in which you are using others, in which your responsibility is just to put together things, like here, I am putting together the frame, and I am putting together the menu, the panel, the label. I am putting together things. Yes, I am highly dependent of others. So I cannot do my work if I do not have access to the API. I cannot do my work if I cannot access to these other classes. I have a high dependency from others. However, you know what? I have freedom because I can change whatever I want in the main and no one is going to complain. Why? Because whatever I do in the main is not affecting others. No one is watching me. I do the things in the main. Yeah, I have a high dependency in what others do. In this case, in the API. But I am free. I can change things with freedom. I can be in Estas. I can be that. I can change. That is the meaning of be non-stable, unstable. I can change and no one is going to complain. Think about the opposite. The opposite example. The opposite one in your project. In your project, I am pretty sure that you have this class wrap. You got the structure for your nodes and your connections. And at least I am sure that you have a workspace, the place in which you draw things. And I am sure that this workspace somehow is using this graph. Somehow because it's calling methods to get the values. or maybe scaling methods to put values there. Also, probably your listeners, when you click and blah, 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 your controllers, probably they are also using the graph. Moreover, maybe you have a class that is storing the graph. This graph, or whatever is the name of this class in your project, what do you think about being the programmer responsible of that class? Maybe you are the programmer responsible of the class that have the data structure with all the information. And there are people inserting data, there are people that want to draw the data, there are people that want to control the data with the listeners. If you have this class graph, do you want to be the responsible of that one or the responsible of the main? And you just notice the main have only lines that go out. This one, what I am showing here is only lines going in. What happens if you change something here? What happens if you make a mistake there? You know what happened? Anything that you change, you need to notify the guys that are working here. Because you know what? You have the power of crashing whatever these guys are doing. Those people depend on you. Those people is going to be checking that you do not crash what they are doing. And you know what? I am sure that you notice that in your project, probably one of the classes with the highest priority, one of the classes that you want to have done first is this one. And if you do not have that one done first, what you have is a lot of communication and probably issues between whoever is modifying this class and whoever is using that class. Why? Because that class have only lines going in, or mostly lines going in, and that means that that one is hard to change. What is the meaning of hard to change? It's not about the content of the class. I am not talking about the cyclomatic complexity of the code inside. I am talking about the problems that as a developer of that class, I am going to have with my team. I am talking about that one should be stable, should be something that you finish first or take care about what are you going to change, because that one have the power to crash not only my work, but the work of the team, other people in the team. That is the example of something that is stable. The meaning of the stable is please do not change. Danger to change. Problems if you modify. Just like that, the lines going in or going out tell you which part of the project is an issue or can be an issue. Not about the complexity of the lines of code, about your team working. When you have a class like this with a lot of things going in, you check your blueprint, you saw this high priority in your backlog, because that one should be stable, because that one could be a problem. That is the meaning. Now, when you calculate the numbers, something that I mentioned before is, okay, I can calculate the abstraction. And now we know that we can calculate the instability. Notice that the metric is measuring the instability, the capability of modify that thing. When you have those two numbers, you can use them in this particular plot. I want you to notice that what I have here is this line in which I am going to represent the abstraction metric. And what I have is this line in which I am going to represent the instability metric. What I am going to do is, according with these numbers, put a dot in this 2D space. OK? Okay. You know what happened? If you calculate the numbers and you put the numbers in this plot, what you want to have is your classes or your packages here. In that space in which I put the lines, you want to have your classes or your packages as close as possible to this line. Far from this place, far from this place. Those corners are bad. Why? Let's check. This one first. Let's see. What if I have a class and that class have abstraction equal one? And according with this, well, if I have abstraction equal one, I am going to have for this guy also instability equal one. Can you imagine this in a class diagram? It's like, well, you are talking about one class. This class is abstract, maybe is an interface, whatever. That guy is an interface. And that guy is an interface. And if this one have instability equal one or close to one, what I have according with the equation is basically lines going out. Lines going out, remember, could be anything. Like this one can be inheriting from another one, right? This line can be inheritance. Or this one could have a static variable from another one. Whatever. Inheritance, aggregation, association, the variable is global, this guy is a diamond here. We do not care. But basically, that is what I have. What do you think about something like this? An interface, and the only thing that that interface has is lines going out. Why that thing is considered useless? Useless. Do you mean that no one is using it? Yeah. Who do you know that no one is using that interface? Because using the interface imply a line going in. What can I do with an interface? Create a concrete class. And if you're going to create a concrete class, there is going to be an inheritance. An inheritance is a line going in. Well, I am going to create a variable, global or local. It doesn't matter. It's a line going in with or without the diamond. Local or global, lines going in. If I do not have these lines going in for realization or for using a variable from the interface, what I have is an interface that, yes, is an extension of another interface or is using variables from other classes or interfaces or whatever. Great, the interface have a lot of things connected. It's useless. No one in the system is using that interface. And what I have is this zone here that obviously the worst case scenario did 1-1. But if you think about not a class, but a package, and if you think about this package in which maybe instability is equal to 0.8, an abstraction is equal to the same, I mean, just to move a little bit. What does number represent? Well, abstraction point A in a package, that means that inside of that package, if you have 10 classes, 8 are abstract. So the package is mostly interfaces or abstract classes. And in a package that have this big number or abstract classes, the instability is 8. So that means that if I have probably 10 connections, 8 are connections going out and only 2 going in. And you can imagine if you have a package with 8 interfaces and only 2 lines going in, that basically represents that you are using only 2 of the 8 interfaces there. So that package is in the useless zone. Yeah, someone is using it to connections, but the package is for at least 8 after classes. Use an example. So that package is not really a good option for a package. Remember, what we're thinking about here is reusability, reuse. And if you tell me that the package is just these numbers, probably you need to rethink about the distribution of that package. Probably that is not a good package. The numbers are used red lights. The numbers are used there to help you to take decisions, but the numbers are not magic numbers. It's not like the package is useless just because these numbers. The point is, looks like it's useless. Can you explain why that is happening? Because could look useless for a particular project, but the reason for this is that there are other projects that really need that package with those classes, because in a different project, all the classes, all the interfaces, whatever, are being used. Red light for an explanation. So useless, the opposite. The pain zone. Whatever you have here is going to be the most difficult part of your project. The most difficult part means the classes or the packages that are going to cause problems in your team. Problems between the people. The ones that are going to need more time. More time, communication between the people. And one of the reasons, because we want independency in the classes, is because the people do not want to work together. Yeah, we want to work together, but the first thing that we want is to split the things so you know what to do, your part, and I know what to do, my part, and then we connect. We do not want to be in this situation in which everything that you do can crush my part, or everything that I do can crush your part. We can work together, we are a team, but we want this independence. The pain zone is mostly when we lost that. Pain zone, worst case scenario, I have a package or a class with abstraction 0, and I have the same for instability. And you know what this is? What you have is one class that is not abstract, so it's a real class. That class has methods and variables that are doing something. And instability 0 basically means that the only thing that I have here is lines that are going. In what is a class in which I have only lines going in, like your class graph, in which there is one class that wants to put information inside And there is another class that wants to draw the information, and there is another class that wants to do the listeners, and another class, and another class, and all want to work with that class. That one is not an interface. It's doing something. And there are a lot of people that depend on the service that that class is providing. For the guy that is responsible of doing that class, what do we want to do in our diagrams? When we take the decision of how to connect classes, we want to avoid having these kind of things. Not only the zero, zero, but if you think about packages, obviously with classes is zero, one. It's just the opposite. But if you're talking about packages, if you think in a package in which you have this abstraction, 0.25, 0.2, and instability, 0.2. Again, it is a class in which it's a package in which maybe we have two abstract classes or two interfaces from a total of 10. Very low number of interfaces. Almost everything is a class. And what we have in connections is probably 8 connections going in. And yeah, maybe we have 2 connections going out, something like that. That package is basically classes, and everyone is using that package. It's not a good distribution. It's not a good way to split the work. It's not a good split for putting classes together in packages when you have this one package here. Something that is very, very common, guys. Very, very common for you as students. Do you remember the MVC pattern, Model View Controller? Are you familiar with that? A very common thing that the people do is, well, Model View Controller, yeah. We need to split the model, the view, and the controller. Let's create packages. And let's create 3 packages. One package for the views, one package for the controllers, one package for the model. Yeah, the decision of a naive programmer. Tell me, for this one, the model, how many lines do you think we're going to have going in? And how many lines we're going to have going out? More specifically, if we ask about the instability of that package model, is going to be greater than 0.5 or lower than 0.5? Just ask me for the model in any piece of software with a graphical user interface. Close to 1 or close to 0? Close to 1, why? Do you remember that the model is the one that is doing the functionality of the system? Do you remember that the model is the one that is doing everything? The requirements are in the model. The view is your graphical user interface, the controller are your listeners. So what is going to happen? Okay, now I have ideas about the zeros, and now I have ideas about the one. So I have both options. What do you think is going to happen? Basically, the question is, you think that there are going to be more lines going in or more lines going out? Basically, the question is, do you think that others are going to be using the package model, or you think that the model is going to be using other things mostly? Which are going to be the lines going out? The lines going out are going to be probably for the model, the libraries that you are using. in the model, right? Things that your model is going to use, your libraries, but lines going in. The connection between the classes in the view and the model, the connection between these two guys is going to be a line going into model or out to model. What if I told you that I agree with the chat? Do you remember that the controllers, all your listeners, what they do is to call functionality here? Your listeners call functionality there. Your listeners are going to be calling methods in the model. The view communicate with the controller, the listeners, the controller is going to call the model. That is going to happen. The model. The model is the guy doing everything. The functionality is there. The model is the one being called. It could happen that your model use some libraries, yeah. But mostly, your model is the one doing the work. And if your model is the one doing the work, the model is the one being used. And if the model is the one being used, the worst case scenario, the thing that you need to be careful is to balance the instability of your model and be sure that your model do not go to the pain zone. Put all the functionality of your system in only one package, the model, is a very bad idea. Yeah, your views can be one package. Your controllers can be one package. In your model, usually you need to think about how many packages do you need for your model. This idea or this decision of all the classes that are not controllers, that are not views, you go together to the one folder and they are the model, could create a package that is in the pain zone because you could end with something that have a lot of inputs just because you have a lot of connections, at least with the controller, at least with that. Again, it's not a magic number. It's not a rule that always the model is going to be in the pain zone. It's just something that depending on your project, you need to consider. And it's something, it's the reason because you do not put the model always using one package. That is the reason because the model view controller pattern is not about having three packages. We are talking about three components, and those components can be a collection of classes or a collection of packages or whatever, but it's not about always having three packages because the numbers, the connections. So just as an example, going back here. For your quiz or your exam, can you tell me if this package here, the X, is good or bad? Can you tell me if that package X that is somehow being used by a package C and is using a package A, whatever, is in the pain zone or in the useless zone or where that guy is, maybe is a good one? A good one is something that is in the line. So, if I ask you about the package X, what do you do? Number one, you are going to ask me about the abstraction of X. If I didn't give you more information, the abstraction of X, you know what? There are no abstract classes in that package. Zero. All the classes, I do not know the number, but all the classes are just concrete classes. In that scenario, the other number that you need, the instability of X. Tell me, what is the value for the instability of X? Can you calculate that for your quiz, your exam? Instability of the package X, result. You're going to have that question in the exam, so please remember the question. Inputs, outputs. Could you agree that we have one output? And could you agree that we have one input? So one and one, the instability value is going to be 0, 1, 0.5. Okay, I have the three angles, 0, 1, and 0.5. That is going to be for the multiple choice. Which one is the correct one? 0, 1, or 0.5? Okay, 0.5. Could you agree that it's going to be how many outputs? One divided by how many outputs plus how many inputs? Oh, one input. So one divided by two, so 0.5. Could you agree with that? That is what you are going to do in your quiz. That is what you are going to do in your exam. So tell me, if I just told you that this package have no after classes, everything inside, whatever is the number of classes, is concrete classes, and I have these two connections, therefore instability of 0.5, the instability is in some place around here, but the abstraction is in zero. Good or bad? Package X is a concern or not? Can I be okay with that package, or I need to be worried about that package? 0.5 and zero. It's like that, right? I like that decision, guys. So exactly what you have in the chat is not a concern. I can be worried about other packages. I can put my attention in others. This one is not something that is going to be problematic, not right now. However, there are opportunity for improvement. Why? Because, and you mentioned that correctly, the distance from that one to the line, this distance is opportunity for improvement. The closest the point to this line, the better. Good that the point is outside of the pane, is outside of the useless. That is good, but can be better. We can move this guy close to the line. What can I do to put that package close to the line? What is something that I need to review if I can do and could improve that package? Yeah. An area of opportunity in that package is that the abstraction is zero. An area of opportunity in that package is to have some interfaces in the package. Why? Because the interfaces represent the possibility of having inheritance. The possibility of having inheritance represents the option to reduce the connection. Because instead of connecting with the child, probably I can just connect with the parent, and I can use polymorphic behavior. All that, inheritance, polymorphism, principles is object-oriented. That is the meaning of increasing this number zero to something else. That is the reason because I would like to increase the abstraction of the package. That is the reason because I would like to include abstract classes, because maybe that will represent opportunities for make some polymorphic behavior or some injection of dependencies or whatever. So if I achieve that, if that is possible, I can move this up and therefore have a better package. Okay, I am going to stop here. It's up to you. For the menu, what I am asking you to have is a menu bar. Inside of that menu bar, up to you if you have those options, load, compile, new space in one single menu box, one menu thing with four options, or if you put four items in the bar. Up to you, whatever you want to do. Good? Okay, guys, I stop here. We continue next lecture. Please do not forget to submit. Thank you.